One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show.
O'clock on the dot.
7 o'clock. We're live. Welcome to the Cash Bar. How are you, Diane?
I'm hungover. I'm good though. I'm good. I'm getting through it.
How did you get your hangover installed this time, you lush?
I mixed. Ben, I know better than to mix. I had like 3 delicious cognac cocktails at a steakhouse last night. And then we're like, let's go have wine, go to a wine bar and then put white wine on top of it. Like that's, I know, Ben, I know not to do it. I know not to do it. What is it about cocktails that makes you forget not to do that?
Cognac will talk to you, man. Beer is for boys. Whiskey is for men. Brandy is for heroes. They've been saying that for centuries. It was your inner hero talking to you, Diane.
I do not feel
inner
heroic.
Inner sword-swinging Viking saying, have another.
Have wine. Go have wine now, though. Like, and wake up. I mean, that hangxiety is a thing that I didn't have with hangovers in my 20s, but in my 30s, I started having it. And then in my 40s, it's crushing. Like it was taking me down this morning. I was like, I'm a bad mother. I couldn't get Charlie on the bus. I had to make Corbin do it. I was like, my world is closing in. God.
I can feel him coming the night before now. We're here with our good friend, veteran bartender, veteran comedian, veteran hangover having man, veteran painter, and a full luscious beard. Paul Oddo. How are you doing, Paul?
Hey, how's it going, guys? Thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. How's your hangover?
It's pretty constant, but I'm used to it. No, not so bad. I had a few drinks last night. I was streaming on Reddit and working on a painting, so I had a couple of tequilas and nothing too bad. I have a weird thing about hangovers where it makes me a little elated in some way. Maybe it's the same way that people like enjoy a type of pain, I guess. It makes you feel a lot, feel something. Maybe the way cutters get, you know?
You've talked about this before, and I'm like, you're out of your mind that you enjoy this pain.
Yeah, it's really a broader issue, I think, that it's tapping into with me, that I kind of am only comfortable when I'm uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, but I'm okay. I went and rode my bike around, so I feel all right here in Austin, Texas.
Yes.
Got hills in. It's a whole other idea riding a bike around here.
Oh, what's different? Are you saying than New York?
Than here or in Houston where it's all kind of flat.
Oh,
but
yeah.
You got to go do the hills and shit. And I don't have a bike with any, I just have the one gear because it was cheaper when I bought it like that. And yeah, so you earn it. That's good.
I don't have the thighs to go and do hills. And I'm also always far too hungover to go and do hills. Like, are you crazy? There are better ways to sweat this out.
For sure.
Plus, I'm enjoying feeling haggard. You know who else enjoys feeling haggard? The subject of our show today.
Yes.
We're doing John Mellencamp. It's just John Mellencamp. I think he hates being called Johnny Cougar. He hates it. But I think Johnny Cougar's a great name. I know it's corny and everything like that, but Johnny Cougar's a great name.
Is it his real name?
No, his real name's John Mellencamp, but he got he was a good looking young kid from the middle of nowhere. So he went to New York to get a record contract, and the record label guy, who was the manager of David Bowie, said, "Okay, well, we're going to call you Johnny Cougar." And he was like, "I don't want to be called Johnny Cougar." He's like, "Well, we're not going to put your fucking album out then." So, okay, I'll be Johnny Cougar. And then he went from Johnny Cougar to John Cougar Mellencamp, and then finally to John Mellencamp by his third or fourth album. So it took him a while to get control of his name, but he got it in the end.
Yeah.
Wow.
He's a stubborn bastard, apparently, too.
So yeah, that's what we've heard. I didn't do a whole lot of research on him being an asshat, but someone else did, and we're going to hear from them later. just Jeremy will come on with his segment. Yeah. He's like,
to be clear, I don't think he's an asshat, and stubborn bastard is a full-throated compliment from me.
Oh, okay.
And it's a fun nickname. Like, if you're just like, before it meant like older woman that preys on younger men, but like it would fit. Like, if you were just coming up with your own nickname, it's like Cougar.
Yeah.
What is it with that? So Lance Berkman, you know, Astros player, everyone called him Fat Elvis, and that was
great nickname.
And he hated it. He's the one that named himself Big Puma. He's like, no, guys, call me Big Puma. And everybody's like, okay, Fat Elvis.
Yeah, you have to just own it. You have to just go in there and be like, I'm fucking Fat Elvis. Like, wear the shit too. Yep. You know, just go for it.
You can't nickname yourself, all right? Take it from this 42-year-old man who's routinely referred to as Princess, okay? You can't nickname yourself. There's nothing you can do about it, Princess.
It doesn't, it just blows back. Like, if you try to adjust it, you're like, okay, Super Princess. Like, it's just double down. Yeah, they bring you fucking crystal slippers and shit to work. Yeah.
So, I really like John Mellencamp because I really enjoy guys like Mellencamp. And Springsteen to a degree, and who else am I thinking of? Maybe like Chris Christopherson, where they end up, they kind of have that "I am America" sort of standpoint. You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. I'm here to describe and define you. Like, that is a really arrogant thing to set out to do, but sometimes they do it.
Such a big way.
They represent America's heartland. There was something about like this group of guys in the 80s and some of these songs, like Tom Petty's American Girl, and then, you know, everything Bruce Springsteen was doing, and then John Mellencamp, that's usually we see now reserved for country music, but it was very America from like mainstream pop and rock and roll then, and now it's kind of moved over to country only doing it.
Yeah, now it's completely split. That whole mentality has just gone country.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the country people, like, there's, I think we talked about it in a Bruce Springsteen episode, but there's a Bruce backlash in the country world as well, because Bruce is far too liberal, Paul. Far too liberal.
Yeah, you can't like America and also have a divergent political opinion.
Yeah,
apparently that's the way it works now and again. But I think it's not, like, he did a podcast with Barack Obama, and that was a bridge too far.
Fucking traitor.
Damn to right.
A president. Yeah, the lines are very, very strange now. It's like, it's so weird.
They're not lines anymore. They're walls and they're heavily gunned.
In a big way, all over the place. So bizarre. I was talking to another streamer guy on Reddit the other day who was, he had, for whatever reason, decided he's like, just, I'm a conservative. Tell me why I'm wrong. And just kind of like picking a fight with the world, I guess. And and it was interesting because he's kind of a younger guy and he wasn't like out of his mind. He was just explaining. He's like, I have conservative political opinions and I'm willing to talk to you about them and shit. And I kept kind of like talking to him about it and dealing with the nuances of it. And he wasn't like off the rails, but I kept just saying, what I need to know is how you justify Trump. Like, that's that's all I need to know. And as far as all this goes. And I kept saying it, and he kept just kind of skipping past the question, right? And I kept asking, not in a shitty way, just being like, but once again, how do you get around the Trump thing? And then I eventually said, hey man, are you not seeing the comments that I'm asking about the 45th president of the United States? He's like, I haven't seen any of those. And what? He said, yeah, I've seen nothing about Trump posted on here. I was like, so they're filtering out the word Trump as I type it in. So it didn't.
Interesting.
So, and both of us were like, that's fucking weird.
Unless he's lying.
Yeah. He was not the type. Okay. Like, I was, because then we went on a whole thing about that. He's like, yeah, that's fucking strange. He's like, I don't have a problem talking about Trump, but it's real weird that it just censors out the thing. I was like, yeah.
You think the bots are just tired? They're like, no, we're done. I don't want to hear it anymore.
I think it triggers a complete shit starting thing. They're just like, just cut this out before it even gets. Like,
the AI has just decided that name causes all the trouble. We'll just take that out right now.
Yeah.
Right. And what's actually it more to that point specifically was then once we started talking about it, the fucking floodgates opened up and everything became about that. And everybody started fighting with each other where it was kind of a civilized conversation. And it was just like throwing gas on yeah. this fire, and it just kept growing. It's like, okay, this is, I'm going to leave you with that. But this is the problem, in case you're wondering what the problem is with beef. This is specifically the issue.
Yeah.
You gotta think about him, you'd almost have sort of some weird high grounds to be on, to be honest.
Yeah.
But this doesn't work. Just like as far as getting along with each other.
The AI has two solutions. We can delete that one name every time it crops up, or we can activate Skynet. All right.
Yeah. I was gonna say
the reason why, you know, we were supposed to have like different guests and stuff, and then I still wanted to do a live YouTube live this week, and then I saw Paul, you posted something about the song and the one lyric that everybody's waiting for, and I was like, that's what we're doing.
I guess I figure out what it is that I said for when it comes up. Yeah,
you'll know when it comes up.
I remember the wording.
Yeah. We're doing Jack and Diane. It's probably the most famous song by John. It was John Cougar Mellencamp at the time. He's John Mellencamp now. Mm-hmm. These are the lyrics.
Little ditty about Jack and Diane, two American kids growing up in the heartland. Jack is gonna be a football star. Diane's debutante backseat of Jackie's car.
Little ditty about Jack and Diane, two American kids growing up in the heartland. It's hard to sing that song without getting into the rhythm of it. Jackie gonna be a football star. Diane's debutante backseat of Jackie's car. While I was reading about this song, I found out that I guess Mellencamp's original plan was to make this an interracial couple.
Like yeah.
He was going on tour and he was seeing a lot of mixed race couples. He's like from a small town in Indiana. So that was kind of a new thing. He was like living in a new America. So he wanted to write a song about that, about these new American couples. When he took it to the record label, they were like, I don't know if we want you stepping on that hornet's nest, John Cougar Mellencamp.
Johnny Cougar.
We're looking for a big radio hit here. I don't know if we really want to get into America's womb.
It makes me laugh because I was like, how was he going to restructure the lyrics to this song? And I was singing Black and Diane. But I don't know.
Yeah, oh, I'm God. Curious.
I hope it wasn't that.
Where would you fit that into this story? Because I'm looking at the lyrics here. Yeah, I don't
It would have been totally different. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. Apparently, I have no idea what the original lyrics were, but apparently it's the Jackie going to be a football star line that he specifically had to change. So whatever, however he described or introduced the listener to Jackie, that was probably where the
Jackie's going to be a football star. So mm-hmm. Jack, he's a black guy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just so you know, Jack is a, what's the word? How do you prefer it? He's African American.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. And then I guess we got to change the last part of the next line. I don't know. It's just to make it rhyme. I don't know. Yeah. I'm no song man.
You know, lyricist.
Yes. There it is.
There it is.
That wasn't a big enough hint.
Diane's debutante backseat of Jackie's car. So she loses her virginity. She comes out to society in the backseat of Jackie's
car. Is that what that means? I have so many questions and I have misheard lyrics in this song. I was like, debutante. So that's. Debutante. I mean, I know what a debutante is, but I didn't know that lyric suggested, like, I mean, I knew they were like probably making out and stuff, but like she lost her virginity in the backseat.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I think that's definitely what they're saying. There's basically like your debutante ball is where you're introduced to the world, right?
Okay.
Like your father, it's like your quinceañera, your father is basically announcing, I have a grown woman in my house. Isn't she beautiful?
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't do that in Indiana.
Instead, we don't do that at all anymore, thank God.
Nah, we just get naked in the backseat of our cars.
Yeah, yeah. It's way better. Mm-hmm. I've never had sex in a car, by the way. I always like to freak people out with that because that's something everyone has done but me. Never in a vehicle.
Yeah.
No, sorry. I was just going to say when I was a teenager, because we had, you know, there was no place to do anything. Like I did it in a lot of weird places.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah, you ever tried the 69?
Yeah, we've talked about this. In a car?
Same kind of clumsy concept. It just doesn't. Like, not really.
Yeah, nobody tries the 69 after like 25.
Oh. Yeah. No. But you have to understand this is nonsense.
Can you imagine somebody like trying it now and you're just like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, it doesn't know. It doesn't work.
It's too cold.
My keys are not here. I don't know how we ended up. We've looked everywhere now. Yeah.
I don't want to, I can derail this whole podcast with this conversation and make it an hour, but I'm just going to say real quick, we were drunk playing telestrations with some of my girlfriends and we had to draw 69 and pass it around the table. And two of my friends at the table drew the guy on top.
Oh boy.
And oh, the whole night went off the rails because we're like, why do you think that's how it's done?
They kind of like timid, scared people because that seems like that would do that to you. Like,
guy on top 69 is just a weird mixture of moods. Like, I'm feeling very aggressive and also very generous.
Yeah. I can't get the visual out of my head of like splitting a log with an awl.
I can't imagine like how a woman would react to like not just to like being forced into a guy on top 69, but I could also see women be like, get your filthy feet away from my pillows, you monster.
Yeah.
It was her idea. She's the one who fought for it.
Yeah. Oh, really?
She said, I don't even know who's watching this or if anyone is, and I don't want to make it too dirty, but she's like, I just don't want my butt in the air like that. And I was like, but the trade-off is better.
Yeah. You're kind of dick waterboarded otherwise. Like, I don't.
so bad. All right. Let's get on to the most famous line of this. Speaking of the most famous line of this song.
Sucking on chili dog, outside taste freeze. Diane sitting on Jackie's lap, got his hands between her knees. Jackie say, hey Diane, let's run off behind the shady trees. Dribble off those Bobbie Brooks, let me do what I please. Say,
sucking on a chili dog, outside the tasty freeze. Poor word choice, Mr. Mellencamp. Yeah.
But it paints a picture. This, the minute he said that, I'm like, small town, got it.
I found what I wrote about it as far as the tweet was. It was, I want to see John Mellencamp watch a montage of the hundreds upon thousands of people that have winced uncomfortably upon hearing the line, sucking on a chili dog outside tasty free. Because it doesn't like upset you, but every time you hear it, you're like, we didn't need that. That's all it's ever been. You just kind of look at the speaker in your car. You're like, why did you say? It's just a hitch somewhere to the point where you really think there had to have been a conversation at the record label or whatever. Just like, John, we've brought a chili dog in for you. I just want to know how you eat it before we board with it. And if he really does fully just like, all right then, well I guess this is his way.
I just like the idea that he just really really loves chili, like, you know, like the way a little kid will scrape all the icing off a birthday cake. Yeah. That's literally how he just, no, like he puts the whole sausage into his mouth and then just like licks it clean and wet, puts it back in the bun. I'm done, thanks.
That was odd. Ask the taste freeze, like, what the fuck is that kid doing that thing? That's not right. This is a small town. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I will eat the chili, the cheese, the onions, the ketchup, and the mustard, but I am not touching that sausage. That is all pig lips and anus.
Oh, it was just a life-changing experience in the back of that car, I guess.
I guess so. Well, what's funny is they're outside of Tasty Freeze. They're at an ice cream place. They couldn't be sucking on an ice cream cone.
Right.
Sucking on a thing that's phallic and you suck on it.
Yeah. Did you bring that chili dog from home? We sell ice cream here. You freak.
The things that are meant to be licked. I mean.
Yeah.
And in the video, I don't know if you went back and watched that old video, a lot of the footage is just his photos and home videos from like high school, but then they film him as Jack and this blonde girl is Diane. And on that line, it's her sitting on his lap. He's got his hands between her knees and she's just double handing, eating a chili dog. Like, okay. And I was like, I think it has to be a personal story of his, like relates to his real life, that he's just, that's his little wink in there. Like,
hey, yeah, it's more than a wink. It's a, get it? Like a dick. That's what it's like. It's like sucking a dick. And, but it's a Philly dog. You guys get it. Carrying on with the song.
Diane sits on Jackie's lap. He's got his hands between her knees. Jackie says, hey, Diane, let's run off behind the shady trees. Dribble off those Bobbie Brooks. Let me do what I please. Now,
let's talk about that.
Yeah, I've never had Jackie's confidence. Like, I've never said anything like that. I've never been that direct, whether with a woman that I was on a single date with or a woman that I've been with for years. I don't think I have ever directly asked for sex.
You think I have, like,
I believe you.
No. I can't imagine literally gonna dribble off those Bobbie Brooks, let me do what I please. Like, I can't pull that off.
And you explain
the first part of that sounds like you're having an aneurysm.
What is it? I never knew what he was saying here. When I'd be in my car, I'd be like, dribble off those me do it. I was like, I don't know what he's saying. What are Bobbie Brooks? Is it shorts, pants, clothes?
Maybe that's Daisy Dukes where he comes from.
I always thought that they were shorts.
Okay. And also, is this America's heartland poetry for let's go fuck in the woods? Yeah. Like, is that a better way of saying it?
Yeah. Because the way you just said it just doesn't sound romantic. I'm gonna go fuck in the woods.
And it's not like, let's go make love. It's let me do what I please.
Yeah.
It's, whoa, what? I'm gonna go rape you in the woods. Can you consent?
Yeah, Jackie's time right now. Next. I paid for the chili dog. That's where my part of this stops.
we're making it too dirty. Dribble off those Bobbie Brooks. Like, Bobbie Brooks are just like sandals or something like that. Like, all he was just saying is like, let's just go play in the grass.
That's it.
You wanna go feel that wet dew between your toes? Come on, Diane. You know you do. We're gonna go down to a
You done eating that hot dog?
Yeah, let me wipe all that bullshit off your face. It looked like you were just doing something weird.
Oh yeah, life goes on long after the thrill of living is gone. Say, oh yeah, life goes on long after the thrill of living is gone. The walk on.
Which you
oh yeah, life goes on long after the thrill of living is gone. And he repeats that. Oh yeah, life goes on long after the thrill of living is gone. I wonder, and this is just occurring to me now, this is really just kind of a dumb thought, but I wonder if that's like a dude's like post-orgasm like cry out where he's just like, hey baby, dribble off them Bobbie Brooks, let me do what I please, and then everything is all finished. He's just like, well, looks like this night's gonna go on long after what I wanted. Do we have to talk now? Do we have to go back to the Tasty Freeze? Do you need an ice cream cone?
This is definitely the part that always made me feel that it's like, you know, him reminiscing about being younger and all that.
Yeah.
But sure. Yeah, always did have a specifically like depressing part of it, you know. It's like, it just keeps going after long after you've sucked all the proverbial chili off the dog. Yeah, just keeps on going. Yeah,
I saw where he talks about this song and he's saying this song is about a young couple falling in love like for the first time, and he is saying basically your teenage years are the best years of your life, but life still has to go on after that. And I always have such a problem with these peaked in high school people where I was like, those 4 years in high school for me strung together were the most insignificant 4 years of my life. I mean, I think 28 to 32 was my best 4 years strung together. And my husband, and he's like, we have a child, Diane, but which you had later. But like those 4 years of high school meant nothing to me. And so many people are like, best years of your life. I'm like, I don't know.
Well, this very much, in my opinion, speaks to the middle America.
Yeah. Football.
Kind of like not the way everybody in middle America necessarily feels like, but this is the placating to that like sort of you guys know that was the best time. Now you do a job you don't like, and it will never be as good as that. And just accept it. Yeah. Do not unionize. Like, it's kind of that feeling, you know? It's like, it peaked, and that was great, and now you're just kind of unhappy, and that's life. And that's a sad narrative that we're kind of, like, constantly forced to think is real, but it's not.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of factors. Like, I think this song was written at a time when that was like the life cycle, you know, like you went to high school, you had your first sexual experiences, your first drunks, you know, all those good times. And then you get out of high school, you get a job at the factory, you get married, you have a kid, and the cycle repeats itself. Yeah. So like, all you're doing is raising a child for those glory moments. And then it's going to happen again. That doesn't happen with our generation, because we either have kids later, Diane, or we don't have them at all.
Yeah.
Right. Right. And also it is, I think there is some, like, truth to the concept of, like, life goes on, like, and as you get older, it is hard. And there are many things that are not, like, just childlike fun about it. And that is an honest and healthy thing to sort of just be aware of. Right. But it's not necessarily, like, it's over. It's just, it's complicated. Things get complicated as you get older.
You're gonna have bills and a mortgage, and you know, no more sucking on chili dogs in the woods. Sorry,
sucking on chili dogs ain't gonna pay the bills unless you're doing it on TikTok and dancing.
You have an OnlyFans,
right? Yeah,
Jackie sits back, collects his thoughts for a moment, scratches his head, and does his best James Dean. Okay. Well, you know, Diane, we ought to run off to the city, and Diane says, baby, you ain't missing nothing. I only realized as I was doing the research for this song that this is one of my favorite songwriting techniques. It works two ways, and it works in two completely opposite directions. I always thought that Diane saying, baby, you ain't missing nothing, she was like totally agreeing. Like, yeah, let's go to the city, you know? You're right, Jackie. Everything you say is perfect, but really, like, you could totally interpret it as saying, like, why do you want to go to the city for? You
know, that's what I thought. Right here.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where I thought.
I'd never thought of it that way. I always thought of it the other way. I always thought of it as being like enthusiastically, yep, let's go to the city right now.
Oh no, I think Diane likes the chili dog tasty freeze life, and he's like, maybe there's something more out there. Yeah.
Like, we found our patch in the woods.
Yeah.
What do we find a whole new woods fuck area? I don't even know if they got woods in the city.
Yeah. We want to continue our outdoor kink. It's going to have to be behind a dumpster or something like that. No, let's stay here.
Indoor plants? Jack, you're going. You're getting too big.
The fake ficus is not doing it for me in this New York apartment.
Yeah.
They do the chorus again, and then he goes into the, I guess it's the bridge. Gonna let it rock, let it roll.
Hold on. Can we talk about the drum fill real quick? Because in between those lines, you hit the drum fill, which was almost as famous as Phil Collins in the Air Tonight drum fill. And he even does the air drums in the video. And it's pretty much, it was Phil Collins or somebody was quoted as saying, this song and Phil Collins song, everyone does it. Everyone does the drum fill to this one.
They're very similar now that I had never really thought about that, but they're very, very similar. But
well, there's a story about it that we can get to later, but like the drummer that they hired for this, he was freaking out because they had a drum machine at first and it wasn't really working out. And John Mellencamp came to him and it was kind of a last minute thing and was like, I need you to go do a good drum fill. Like, you need to create one because what we're doing isn't working. And this guy had been freaking out thinking like, the future of drummers is at stake in the 80s with these drum machines. And so he went in there and just gave it his all.
I see him putting on a headband. Like, I got you. This John Henry versus the steam. Yeah, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Oh, let it rock.
Hold on to 16 as long as you can. Changes come around real soon, make us women and men. What's he saying about the Bible Belt there? Gonna let it rock, let it roll, let the Bible Belt come and save my soul. Like, was that, is that pro, con? Like, I don't know which way the wind is blowing on that one. Pro?
Pro. He's like, you gotta stay. It's one of those, like, you know, simple man, like stay true to your Southern roots, values and stuff. I think he thinks going on to the city will kind of ruin you, which my great grandmother told me when I was very little, don't ever move to New York or LA. It's where all the sinners are. I was like, Granny, there is so much meth in this small town.
That just seems like red meat to me to just throw at the constituency. And it's like, farmers are going to listen to this. We've already put them through that chili dog thing. And the girl's clearly a whore. So we got otherwise, I mean, we are, what are we going to make it interracial? I mean, give me a fucking
little ditty about Jack and Diane, two American kids. Done. The best they can. You got it. Done the best they can.
I have two things. First of all, I had a misheard song lyric with changes coming around real soon, make us women and men. So simple, but I thought he was saying changes coming around real soon, make us swim in it, man. Like swim, like go with the flow. You gotta swim with it, which both make sense. It's not a big one. But I want to say at the very end of the song, so I was like seven, maybe five. I was very young when the song was popular, maybe really young. And I just remember my mom and my aunts, they would just like, at the very end when his voice drops and he's like, best they can, like they, it just send tingles up their spines. I remember them being like, woo, like they left.
Where he like looks at the camera. It's like, they can. Let me do it. I'm John Cougar Mellon.
I just remember back then, like my mom was very young when she had me. So she very much still had this like teen energy, and they loved him and Bruce Springsteen. And then like Burt Reynolds, like, and I was always like, as a little kid, you're like, I don't know what, I don't get this at all.
Yeah. I remember hearing some moms talking about, was it Randy Travis? There was a couple of country guys that I remember moms being like, we can't talk about him in front of the kids.
Randy Travis was a handsome cutie that
George Strait.
My mom's friends loved.
Must've been George Strait. Yeah. Must've been George Strait. Yeah. And who was the guy who was the, I can never remember his name. He was in Silence of the Lambs for just a brief cameo. And he did that song about like, where he was like.
Dwight Yoakam?
No.
No, he wasn't in Silence of the Lambs.
Not attractive. but he was, he was a very handsome guy. He was like one of the FBI dudes it was like a weird cameo. He did Chris Isaac.
Oh, yes. Yes. Chris Isaac. Wicked Game.
Yes, everybody knows their moms wanted to bang Chris Isaac. Just something you find out. Yeah,
the syrupy-voiced Chris Isaac. It takes a robot not to cry at that song.
It's a good song.
It was pretty good, and it was a sexy video, black and white with a supermodel.
Yeah,
on the beach. Yeah, that was good.
Softcore. Yeah, full on.
All right.
I think they threw every hook that they could imagine into this song. Like the more, I listened to it after doing a couple of hundred episodes of a musical podcast. I think about music a little bit differently because I've heard so many people or read about so many people, how they write it and how they put everything together. Like you got the great chorus, like the, oh yeah, life goes on. That's the hook. There's like three different guitar hooks in it. There's the real gentle acoustic guitar. There's the big booming chords. There's the drum fill. There's the clapping. It was just like they did everything they possibly could. Like obviously this was John Cougar saying, I need a hit. I need a fucking hit.
It really does feel like a genetically engineered hit. Mm-hmm. Like, it seems like it's got all the things you need. Yeah, exactly. Americana, all those musical things that you're talking about. And then plus like you're hitting Bible, sex, age stuff, like all that small town, all of it. Just like,
It amazes me that there are artists that can get to that level in anything, but I guess it's most pronounced in music, where they're literally in the studio with their band or whoever's around them, and they're literally trying to write the song that's going to be all over the radio this summer. Mm-hmm. Like that's what Taylor Swift does. That's what Machine Gun Kelly does. It's crazy to think that that's the goal and not a thing that just kind of, I always thought of it as just accidentally happening. Just like DJs go, that song's great. People start calling in, then it sort of spreads organically. That's not the way it happens at all. Obviously they're in there trying to write a good song. I'm not dumb enough to think that they're not trying to write a great song, but that they're deliberately using the hooks and tools and tricks to go nationwide or worldwide.
Yeah, like there's certain formulas that you can apply to these things. Yeah, isn't there some Swedish songwriter who writes all those pop songs and shit, and he just gets, I forget his name, but he's written a ton of like big hits.
Yeah, he wrote like "Oops, I Did It Again," like all of Britney Spears' early hits, the Backstreet Boys' early hits. Apparently, yeah, there's a Swedish
artist
that is the Svengali of that sort.
Yeah, he just gets it. Mm-hmm. It's like the work. Yeah, he did the "I Kissed a Girl" thing.
So,
Barry one.
Mm-hmm. Or he did get it. He's probably in his 40s now and unable to relate to the youngins anymore. Well, I've had my moment, made my money, bought my hooker island. I'm done.
Yeah, I mean, he just like spins in a circle for 2 minutes and does it again. I mean, all you got to really do is dumb yourself down more. And be like, you know, be like, love's forever. Nobody's going to fall out of love. Sex is the most important thing. You know, all these like nonsensical kid things that you're like, all this shit matters. Yeah, it's all magic.
They know.
Anytime I'm stuck for an idea, I lick the chili off a hot dog and go fuck outside, man.
Well, we have this conversation all the time about like, I don't love mainstream pop music most of the time, even the stuff that's catchy. And I was thinking about it the other day, like, why? And because I was listening to a song and I'm like, I know what it is. It's, we like lyrics. We like poetry. I want better lyrics. And mainstream pop songs are usually just kind of baseline, nothing too deep, nothing you got to think about too hard. And they're repetitive to a point that I get mad and change the channel. I'm like, how many times are you going to say that same line over and over?
Yeah.
Like, stop. And it's just, you know, expanding the time of the play. It's getting the earworm in your head. And I'm like, I don't respect this choice. I don't like it.
It's wild. So I'm back to driving now. I, you know, having moved back from New York, I'm here in Austin. I have a truck. It's a hand-me-down truck. It was my grandpa's truck. And it's not like old, but it has a CD player, but what good is that?
Do you have CDs?
No. I left all those in my fucking disc booklet somewhere in a fucking, who knows, it's in a pile. But now I just have to listen to the radio. And it's like 20 songs.
Yeah.
Just over and over again. And it's like they're cattle prodding people into buying Spotify subscriptions.
Yeah.
It's so crazy. They're just like, you guys don't think this is insane to just keep doing this over and over and over again? It's bizarre.
That's why it's called Top 40 Radio, basically. I mean, they're just recycling. Yeah. Like, these are the hit. This is all you're going to hear. I mean, you say you have an old truck, so you can't get like serious and all that stuff. Like, I listen to podcasts and comedy in my car. I have no clue what's going on in the world of music. I don't have access. I have
a Bluetooth speaker. That's all I try to do. I just try to put like, I'll charge up my little Bluetooth speaker and keep that in the seat next to me so I can listen to podcasts, or I can listen to, you know, one of my favorite rock, the Cash Bar, obviously, or like, you know, just anything else.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is. You would have thought that they would kind of age out of this paradigm, that they're like, you know, we should just play the same shit over and over again and people won't get tired of that with limitless options. It's real strange, but the pop music is the way that it is, I guess.
Yeah, but that was it. I was like, it was lyrics that don't make me think deeper than I kissed a girl and I liked it. No offense, Katie, and the repetitiveness, I'm like, move on. Stop saying the same line.
Something. The stations here in Austin have a little bit more variety because there are, you know, a little bit more music geeky stuff here. So you do get a little bit more like college radio stuff from time to time, but you know, same kind of thing though.
Yeah. I did want to talk about his identity. Like I said, like you mentioned earlier, they named him Johnny Cougar. It's the same guy that named David Bowie. And he didn't like it. But he was struggling, like they were really pushing. He was so young. They were pushing this notion on him, like, you have to make an identity. You have to have your thing. That's what you do in this world. And he said one of his friends, a girl, told him, John, just be a pair of blue jeans. That's what you are. And the great thing about blue jeans is you can dress them up or you can dress them down.
That's a great quote.
That is good.
Yeah. And so I think he leaned into that hard and it worked for him. Although Was Bruce Springsteen already Blue Jeans?
I think Born in the USA was out in like 1983 or 84, so it was later on. I think that's his famous, you know, that's the famous Blue Jean against the American flag, you know,
album cover. He was also like Blue Jeans in coveralls. He had like a little bit more like working man shit that is all fabricated also, but still.
Yeah.
I think it's important to notice too, this blew my mind today reading this. Paul, you'll like this. He is a very talented painter, and that's what he was going to do if music didn't work out for him. And he actually still does. And one of his paintings hangs in the governor's mansion in Indiana.
I'll have to look at that.
I know.
Yeah, reading about his life now is both, it's weird. Like it's both, it sounds like idyllic and also a little bit sad. He got married when he was real young, like when he graduated high school, he got married because his girlfriend was pregnant. So he was a father by the time he was just like right out of high school. And that he was a father to a daughter. That daughter grew up, and when she was 18, she had a child. So he was a grandfather by the time he was 37 years old. So if John Mellencamp feels old, it's because that's life made him old pretty quick.
Yeah.
But he got remarried to, you know, to the L.A. doll. He married an L.A. doll and brought her to this small town.
Yeah.
He married her, had two sons with her, and they eventually split up. And I was reading this really kind of, it was a sad and yet idyllic article where they're talking about his art and what he does. They said that he's got a room above his barn on his great big, like 65 acre, we would call it a ranch. I guess they call it a farm in Indiana, but that's where he does his painting. And he says, I go in there at 8 o'clock in the morning and I stay in there until dark. You know, it would be fantastic.
Sound familiar, Paul?
Yeah, that's perfect. That's yeah.
But it was also really sad because he's talking about his sons have gone away to school and he's since broken up with his wife. So he goes, you know, I used to, you know, come home from work or come down from the studio and say, you know, things like, hey, who's happy to see daddy? And there would be three voices, you know, like I am in a chorus. He goes, now I walk in the house and nobody says anything.
Like, Jesus. Oh,
John.
The struggles of being an egomaniac.
He literally wrote about this. It was coming. Life goes on after the thrill of living is gone.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
That's where he's sitting right now.
Yeah. Just eating a chili dog with a knife and fork.
Actually, it just has mustard on it now.
Yeah. Who's got time for the chili anymore?
Gives me heartburn.
Pots and pans. Just chili out of the can. It's just a sad situation.
I just love it. I think nothing says it's been a long life like John Mellencamp eating a chili dog with a knife and fork. Like, things change. People change. You live, you learn, you grow.
Move to the big city.
Oh my God. It's on a real porcelain plate.
Yeah. He's all fucking there. The end of There Will Be Blood. Like in his own like bowling alley and everything. That chili's been had.
I would love to see his studio. Like it, both his painting studio and his music studio. Like I'm a little... The more I read about these people, the more that you learn about their process and how they do it. Like it would just be so fascinating to be in like John Mellencamp's studio or Tom Petty's warehouse or something like these are the guys who have done these things that are going to stand the test of time that have been in my brain as long as I've had it, you know, and this is the space where they do it. Like this is how they produce it. Like it would just be so eye-opening to me. Just go, holy crap, this is a real thing that people really do.
Yeah,
I love stuff like that. I love seeing the inside of people's studios and things like that. There was an episode of Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee, Seinfeld's thing, where he went and got Jim Carrey and went around with Jim Carrey, and it was a fun episode. But he met Jim Carrey at his, because Jim Carrey's become like a very prolific painter. He does that just all day, every day, and he met him at his studio, and it's just this enormous space and just as much paint as you could possibly ever want, like all these racks and giant canvases and shit. And you're like, yeah, that's fun. That's a fun, just a big playground where you can be. Yeah, that is really great.
It's like that retirement dream where people ask you, like, if you had all the money in the world, like, what would you do? And Jim's like, well, I do. And so here's what I'm doing.
Yeah. Yeah. He seems to have gone way into psychedelics, and that's what kind of made him go that direction, is what I heard.
Okay. Yeah. Like a lot like you.
Like, yeah. We have a bit of a difference in our bank accounts, but yeah.
You're getting there though, Paul. What did you have, like 500,000 people watching you paint on Reddit? It's ridiculous.
It's been weird. I think my high watermark now is 650 something thousand.
No way.
Yeah, something insane like that. Or it's like over the course of like an hour, but still, that's like, broke the 500,000 mark. It's like,
yeah.
And it makes me feel so stupid because I'm like, if I can't make $1,000 out of 650,000 people just like passing through my studio apartment, something's wrong with me. You know what I mean? So I'm trying to figure out how to work out the business aspect of it a little bit more. But hey, it is moving in a direction of.
Yeah,
you just started doing this during the pandemic. Like, give yourself some time. It's going to, it's happening.
I'm impatient.
Yeah. We're in that society now where like we see people get famous overnight. We're like, okay, my turn.
Right. Or even, I mean, that's the weird one is fame is almost like a unfortunate potential side effect of this thing that we all do. It's like, really, you just want to have enough to be doing what you want to do. Like you want to fan, you don't necessarily want to be so like weirdly famous that you can't go places and live like a normal person. I think Brian Regan fame was what we all decided is the right way to be.
Perfect.
Where he can always just go wherever he wants to go, but he never has a problem selling on a show. And so you got your diehard fans, and there's plenty of them, but you're just still kind of a regular person. Bill Burr was there for a while. Now he's kind of like tipped into too much, which I think he would probably agree with, to be honest. But yeah, it's that sweet spot where you want to try to find.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
He said if you have 1,000 diehard fans that will buy everything you make, you're fine.
You're good. That's the goal.
Yeah, all that's right. What you're looking for is 1,000 that if you make something, they sell it. If you have a Patreon, they subscribe. Like that's kind of the mark you're looking for as far as just like practical living, you'll be okay. And it makes sense. I mean, if you figure, $5 a month times 1,000 for your Patreon or something, that's great. As far as just like basics. And then not to mention all the stuff that you might sell or shows that you do and all that kind of thing too. So
I admire both your achievement and your confidence. Like I think I would go to pieces. Like I get nervous doing this show and I have to remind myself, like, nobody's listening anyway. Because I was painting
yes, for
500,000 people.
Well, it's just like bartending thing, man. All I do is you would do the same thing. You just switch into bartending mode. And if I could see 500,000 people, that would be different. But because it's just a number on a screen and it's like people writing stuff, it's not, you kind of are just like I went skydiving years and years ago. And I have a similar feeling about that. Like when I jumped out of the plane, you look at that outside and you're like, that's not even real. Like it just doesn't even make sense. So like even when you jump, you don't get that rising stomach in your throat thing because you're just like, this couldn't possibly be happening. And so it's like a disconnect that allows you to sort of like, it doesn't feel like that. It just feels like I'm answering questions and they're coming rapid fire, but it's not like I'm actually looking at all those faces, all those people. That would be a whole different thing. Like if you were if you're performing in like, Madison Square Garden, it just like slammed, that'd be a whole nother level of like anxiety and having to like build up that kind of confidence. But you really just kind of disassociate. It's almost like a slammed bar. You know, when you got that feeling of overwhelm, just like there's too many people ordering drinks. And so you just kind of breathe and you're like, I'm going to talk to you. And then I'm going to talk to you. And all of you guys you'll wait. You see that I'm doing this. And it's kind of got to like bring it back to the center. That makes sense of everything. Otherwise it's like, but I see people fucking melt down. Other I've seen people just like get so overwhelmed. They're like, I don't know, there's all these people. And they'll just like turn the screen off. And like
check out.
Yeah. But I don't know. It's just the internet. It seems less dangerous or something.
Yeah. They're not in your face.
Yeah. I have had people say like, you shouldn't talk shit to people the way that I do, because people will start, you get a bunch of trolls And they come in there and start saying stuff about, hey, fucking, you're bald, you're fucking painting, it's boring, you haven't done anything. It's like, hell, eat shit, fuck off. Go watch cat videos or porno. You don't need to be watching. I paint a fucking squid. You know, it's like, and I've had people send me emails. They're like, you should be careful because you don't know who's crazy or who's not. And it's like, I mean, I'll take the odds.
We've been playing that game with the internet for so long now. Like,
yeah. I mean, you got to think about it like that. I don't mean to dominate the podcast here, but it's like thinking about that, worried about some maniac, like you kind of like already you're just doing a numbers game in your head, right? Like if some psycho is like, I'm going to kill you, there's a pretty good chance that's not going to happen, first of all. And then you got to be like, how many people out there who say that are dedicated enough to figure out where I live, buy a ticket on some airplane, try to get whatever weapon through security, show up at my place, figure out exactly where I live, wait outside with a hammer or whatever, and just like wait for me to walk outside and then be like, you're that fucking guy that told me to fuck myself on the screen. It's like, okay, I'm always mad. I do push-ups every day. I'm ready to just unload craziness on anybody. Let's do this. This is a good way to, like, I don't even...
You just pull your own knife out, like Michael Jackson, like put your arms tied, like, let's go.
I've been waiting for you, deep throat 999.
Attracting crazies was the plan all along.
You fell right into my
spider web. Let me do what I please.
Yeah. I moved back to Texas for the self-defense laws. It was a long game.
Yeah. You guys should do, I think you guys should do some stuff on Reddit at some point.
I know. You got to help me. You got to help me figure out the, because I'm just like, I know that there's Twitch and there's other stuff. And I'm like, I'm juggling so much, but you just got to give me a hand on that.
Yeah, that or TikTok. I mean, I know you got to have like 1,000 people following you on TikTok to do live stuff.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Because it's all about the discoverability. You don't get a lot of high, there's not a high discoverability on a lot of these things, right. You know? And that's one of the good things about Reddit. That's what I enjoy about it so much. It's like you can just stumble on to a whole swell of people because it's new.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, before we move on to 6 degrees of tinted windows, I just wanted to put out, unless you have more, Ben, but this one last little fun fact is that John Cougar Mellencamp was born with spina bifida. And I'll just read this. A condition where the spine is not fully formed. At the time, most kids born that way didn't live very long, but Mellencamp was one of 4 kids who underwent experimental surgery at Riley Children's Hospital in Indianapolis, which saved his life, and the other 3 kids didn't make it.
No shit.
Isn't that crazy?
That's super crazy.
Yeah.
I'm not living anywhere fun.
Oh, you go in the bathroom? Okay.
No. Oh, you got to plug in?
Yep.
Nope, phone dying.
Sorry,
phone
dying.
Anyway, yeah, I just thought, I was like, so no one talks about that more? Like, he almost didn't exist or, you know, didn't live, and then the other 3 didn't make it? Experimental treatment? That's nuts. I can't believe I didn't know that.
That's really nuts. Especially when, like, famous people survive things like that, and then, well, they didn't survive when they were famous, but they survive and then go on to become famous. I always think of that about Tolkien. You know, the guy who wrote J.R.R. Tolkien, wrote the Rings and everything. He was in World War I. And it's so insane to think that he survived World War I and then went on to, you know, it's like stuff like that when so many people were dying.
Right.
It's just such a weird thing to be like, you made it through all this and then you did, damn. All right.
Yeah. You made it through literally a random crapshoot and you made it through with the one human brain that could produce that.
Yeah.
Right. It really just makes it almost that much more like, suspicious or something. You're like, what the fuck's going on? Like, did Zeus pick up your little statue and move you through the, you know?
I think at least in his case, it's got to be like, in a case like that, an extreme case like that, there's got to be a little bit of like, hey, I survived that. It must be for a reason. Like, I got to do something with this. I saw a lot of dudes die. Like, my life's got to matter.
That is a good way to look at that, because I used to have some concept about that too. Like, one of the reasons I don't believe most people when they say they're atheists is because they're not doing enough with their lives, and I always feel like if you really thought there was nothing, you'd be fucking getting up every day and be like, all right, sun's up, here we go, I am gonna write that book, I'm gonna do that thing, I'm gonna do all these things, because this is all we get, you know. Like, Elon Musk told me he was an atheist, I'd be like, that guy definitely doesn't.
He definitely is. But I'm not religious, but I have that thing where like a lot of people get like depressed and we're like, so none of this matters. And I'm like, no, listen, none of it matters. Relax. I stayed in bed all day because none of it matters.
Yeah. Like that's that cool place where mushrooms takes you.
Yeah.
Where it's like that good, that sweet spot with mushrooms where you're like, nothing matters. And that is actually fucking awesome somehow.
Stop stressing so bad. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. It's like an optimistic nihilism.
Yes, sort of. That's what I am.
Yeah. Funny.
It's a better way. Friend who says that she always like sees the absolute or expects the absolute worst from people. And then when she doesn't get that, she's just thrilled. And she's just like the happiest person ever. It's like, well, here's why. Like, I just look at people and just go, and then when they're not as bad as I think they are, it's wonderful.
Yeah, all that's the funny way to do that. But I get it.
All right, I'm going to let Jeremy in and we're going to let him do 6 degrees of tinted windows live with us. Come on, Jared. Hi.
Jeremy.
Hey, buddy.
He's connecting to the audio.
Right, he's almost there.
It's coming. He said this was an easy one.
Okay. Yeah, he was just in Houston, wasn't he?
What's up?
He was just in town, wasn't he, in Houston?
Yeah, yeah. Ben and Jeremy finally got to hang out.
That's fun. And now I think he's just muted.
Yeah.
Sorry, y'all.
There you go.
I'm sorry.
There you are.
Yeah.
Oh, how you doing, buddy?
Good. How are you? I've been watching this show on YouTube. It's good. It's good to see you.
You
is
too.
Anybody else watching? Are you the only one?
I mean, it's so awesome.
Aren't you going to be an Austin?
I'm sorry.
Aren't you going to be such a Midwest way to say sorry? Aren't you going to be in Austin soon?
Yeah, I'll be at Moon Tower and also for the opening of Cap City. So yeah,
I'll see you there. That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's good to see you, buddy.
You too. I will shut the fuck up.
When is Cap City opening up? Anybody? Anybody know?
I'm going to let Jeremy take
it. Oh, when is Cap City opening up?
Yeah.
That's a raw question that you shouldn't ask right now, Ben.
Okay. Sorry.
It's soon would be the answer.
Mm-hmm.
But still up in the air. City permits, you know the fucking city.
All right. Hello? Yeah. Okay, yeah, there's a little bit of delay on you. Okay, maybe it's better now. All right, Jeremy, you said it was an easy one. How are we connecting Johnny Cougar to Tinted Windows?
So I was listening to you guys, and I know I sent this to Diane, but it's like, have any of y'all read his interviews? Like John Mellencamp's?
I read a couple of them, yeah.
He's a sociopath.
tell us about that first.
Like just reading his interviews, I'm like, oh my god, you're insane. And like it's like that Midwestern, because you know Paul brought that up with just the way I say sorry, but like that Midwestern passive aggressive mixed with like, but I also think I'm the greatest. Like so I read so much, like we've done what 100 of these, and like I'm always just like, yeah, that person's kind of crazy, whatever, but like every Mellencamp interview I read, I was like, oh, you're nuts. Like, you're really the worst.
Really. Well, so, can you give us an example? Like, it's just what's one that hit you?
He just keeps talking about how an interview projected him as not the best, but he's also like, yeah, I'm not the best, but I'm also the best. Okay. Like, it's like that Midwestern bullshit where it's just like, yeah, I'm not great, but I'm also great. Like, I don't know. Like, I read like 4 interviews and I was like, oh, you're... I mean, I'm not a huge fan, but I was just like, oh, you're crazy. Yeah. Anyways, I'm sorry. I could be that
type of crazy. Like maybe nobody's watching this, but I'm like, but we're still good.
It was a version of that, but it was more like, I can see why you guys don't think I'm great. So here's why I'm not great, but also I'm great.
Okay. Huh.
It's like a weird Midwestern thing.
I almost married somebody like that. Yeah.
I have married someone like that. So. We've both been there, Paul. Anyways, super quick. So Mellencamp did Farm Aid with Willie Nelson. Willie Nelson album Songbird was co-written and co-produced by Ryan Adams. Ryan Adams was in the band Whiskey Town. James Iha wrote Don't Be Sad for the last Whiskey Town album, Pneumonia. James Iha is in Tinted Windows. So, ta-da.
Mm-hmm.
You do this just off the fly? Like, on, you just kind of think it?
So, we've discussed this. This one, yeah, I could do off the top of my head. Like, this one I knew, like, oh, we did that thing with Willie Nelson. I knew about Songbird. Songbird, like, is a really great, and I think not even on streaming services anymore, Willie Nelson album.
We have that one, yeah.
Do you have that?
Mm-hmm.
It's an amazing album. It's good. It's really, really good. They do a Graham Parsons, $1,000 Wedding is on that. Like, yeah. It's really good. So, Paul, like, generally I do these off the top of my head, but there are occasionally moments where I'm like, well, I need to look that up. But this one, yeah, I totally do off the top of my head.
You don't have, like, red thread connected to shit against your wall, or, like, CDs? Like,
I mean, I do, but in a very different way.
Yeah. Because it does seem, it is such a an interesting, like, just natural talent to have.
I think talent is an overstatement, but I appreciate it.
We'll go with ability? How's that?
Ability. I'll take ability. Yeah, I'll take ability.
That's better. Yeah. So I was going to tell you, Jeremy, initially Mike McRae was going to be on here, and then he had something come up, and we were talking about your segment, and he was like, you know, I used to do that with David Coverdale. Like, that was my thing I would do with David Coverdale. I was like, really?
Well, so I think we discussed this, and I don't want to, like, overtake the show, but, like, I shot a pilot about this.
Okay.
And it was created by me and Mike McRae.
Okay.
It was about how bad Greg Warren's music tastes were. it was largely like taken, I'm sorry, my girlfriend's phone's going off in the background. But like, it was McRae and I developed the pilot about, like, doing this off of how bad Greg's music tastes were.
Okay.
So yeah, he did it with Coverdale. I do it with, I'm sorry, I'm just gonna show their stuff off.
It's time to take a breath control pill.
She's in the bathroom, but I'll tell her that you said to do so when she comes out. Because that feels less aggressive. But no, yeah, McRae and I mean, I've played this game with Mike before. So yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he can do it with the one with David Coverdale. You do this, like, I feel like Tommy Stinson is not the end of where you can do this.
No.
No, this is just how I pass time, Paul. I'm a sad person.
I like it.
I wish I could be a painter. I wish I had your talent, but no. This is just what I do.
Fun one though. It's like an X-Men talent that just didn't get full. You're like, we don't know what to do with that.
Yeah. I'm like Beast Junior, where, like, yeah, no one knows what to do with that guy. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Well, we love it. It's a fun segment.
Yeah, no, I appreciate y'all loving it. But yeah, Paul, it was really good to see you. I know that, like, you guys are probably shutting down and I've got to go because I was traveling all day. But are you going to be at Moon Tower?
Yeah, I'm in Austin. I'm in Moon Tower, so I'll see you around.
All right, well, I got a pass for a guy named Corbin Gallagher, so I'm going to hang out with that guy. And if you want to hang out with him, I'll be around.
I've heard of him.
Yeah, he seems all right. He seems all right.
He's all right.
All right. He's a good guy to know.
Yeah.
I love you guys. It was good to see you.
Bye, Jeremy. Thank you.
Bye, Jeremy.
Bye. Thanks, y'all.
Take care.
Do I have to kick you out? I always get nervous. Okay, there you go. All right. Is there any last words about Mellencamp before we do Guilty Pleasure Songs and then Paul promoting himself?
I think we covered Mr. Mellencamp.
All right.
Yeah. He'll never show his face around here again. Mellencamp's going to show up at Paul's house with a hammer.
It is fun to hear Jeremy describe him as a sociopath, because that is completely what I was imagining when he's talking about, like, I used to come downstairs and my family's not here anymore. It's like, well, maybe this is you. Maybe, you know?
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. Yeah. When you go through enough divorces and shit and you never have, I mean, I don't get the impression that he's like, I've made some mistakes.
You know? He's not admitting to
have that vibe. Yeah. Just runs around with the name Cougar.
Well, we haven't done Guilty Pleasure Songs in a while, but I wanted to do it today because I had one in relation to John Cougar Mellencamp and a story behind it. Mine is Hurt So Good by John Cougar Mellencamp.
Come on, baby, make it hurt so good. Sometimes love.
that's my go-to karaoke song.
Is it really?
Oh yeah.
So the story behind it is when I was very little, when this, what year did this song come out?
That's got to be 81, I think.
Yeah, I was born in 77. Yeah. I was very little when the song came out and I loved it. And it became a party trick in the house that my grandparents would make me, like, Diane, sing that song you like. And I'm like, I remember being kind of embarrassed because I kind of understood what he was saying, but they were like, play for me, puppet. And I was like, all right, I'll do it. But it was like my sweet old grandma was like giggling. And I'm like, come on, baby, make it hurt so good. And then the line, like, sometimes love don't feel like it should. I'm like five. You
know? Yeah. Everybody just kind of.
They were dying laughing. They're like, Diane, do it again. Aunt Jamie's here now. Do it again. Sing her the song.
We'll put some makeup on you. Yeah.
I just, because I remember, I understood sexual activity at a young age, and I knew that it was sexually and kind of raunchy. And I was like, why do they keep making me sing this?
Who are these people? Why are they selling tickets?
What, Grandma?
That's fun. Mine is from the Oh Brother Where Art Thou soundtrack. Mm. It's the Big Rock Candy Mountain.
Oh, which... that's a good one.
In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, you never change your socks, and the little streams of alcohol come a-trickling down the rocks.
Oboe song, and it's on my, so I have like a playlist that I put on while I do the streaming stuff, and sometimes most of the time people don't have any kind of issue with what I'm playing, but I always get somebody being like, what the hell is this thing? And it's a hobo song. It's great.
It's great.
It just talks about all the beautiful aspects of being a homeless person at that time in the world. And it's real fun. And there's some parts in it that are real fun. Just talking about romancing the idea of a whole lake of whiskey where you're just riding around it in a big canoe and you never have to change your socks and all this gross like this.
And they hung the jerk and invented work. Yeah.
Yeah. It's real sad, but also real fun. And it's also, it's sung like, in the Big Rock Candy Mountain, they never change your socks. And it's just really, it's sung like a hobo would sing it. And I don't know why it would be one of, by your definition, I would roll my windows up if I was driving and it came on. And that's probably what defines a guilty pleasure, right?
Yeah. To us, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have one?
I don't know if we've covered this one. I can't believe that if I haven't, then somebody must have by now. But Sister Christian by Night Ranger is definitely. But I listen to it fairly regularly. And of course, I pretend that I'm in that scene from Boogie Nights. Of course I do.
Can you hear me?
Huh? No, we don't hear you.
Fucking scare me.
I don't have a bathrobe because there's nothing more frightening than a 40-year-old dude in a bathrobe. So I just don't have it. I just skip it entirely. But
which
I do like to
pretend
that I'm.
Is it the end?
Yeah, right at the end. It's when the firecrackers with Alfred Molina stealing the whole movie in about 8.5 minutes. Yeah.
Right.
Yes. Sarah Talamash brings that scene up all the time whenever we're talking about like some unsavory place where you're at and you feel like you're not supposed to be, like there's some criminal shit going on. She's like, yep. It makes me feel like that scene in Boogie Nights where that kid's just lighting firecrackers. Like it just feels like some bad stuff's gonna happen at any moment.
Yeah.
It's such a great scene. And you're either born a robe guy or not.
Mm-hmm. I think you're probably right about that. I always have the joke where I just like, I don't own a gun because I'm afraid that I'll just look for reasons to use it. It's the same reason I bought a tuxedo. Also the same reason why I don't own a bathrobe. I just feel like if I had one, like, I'd understand its power.
Yeah.
It's people, guys that do that are way too comfortable with themselves for me.
Yes. It's mm-hmm. aggressively casual.
Yes.
It's like it's like the clothing version of Matthew McConaughey.
That's a perfect analogy.
Yeah,
you gotta write that down.
Intensely casual. that it feels like you're going to get in a fight with me about rolling.
Guys that wear a robe, it's like, they know at any moment their wiener can be hanging out and they're not going to break eye contact with you because they don't care.
Yeah.
That would be a positive thing. We hope it does.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's all your deal. You came into my robe situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My robe vortex. You are in the vortex of the robe.
My robo-dome.
I've got to warn you. This bathroom door is robe event horizon. There's no coming back.
It's great.
Oh my God. I have a package that just got delivered. I broke down and ordered a bidet from Amazon and it has arrived alarmingly fast.
Like, did you order it today?
Today.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
How long was that weighing on your mind? How long until you pulled the trigger on the bidet purchase?
Quite a while.
I would imagine.
Yeah, when I was in New York and I was living with Bob, he bought one and it turned me. I mean, we've talked about this. Yeah. Yep. And so I've been doing it without for a while and you just feel like a peasant, like with a we're past it. And so I just pulled the trigger on it. They're only like $30 and I ordered it and it's like, it'll be there in 5 hours. It's like, you guys can relax. It's not like an emergency. Like, now we know what happens when you need a bidet.
We know what it's like to miss a bidet.
Yeah, you want to be like, take your time. Like, we got you.
We got you, buddy.
Ramble the jets.
Your beehole is going to be sparkling in no time.
I'm going to have that air of superiority. Just, I'll be like John Cougar Mellencamp walking around.
That's perfect. All right, yeah. Paul, before we end this, promote yourself. We've already talked about how you're super famous on Reddit now with your paintings. Oh, tell everybody where to find you.
The easiest way to find me is my website, which is just my name.com, pauloddo.com, O-D-D-O.com. And then I'm on most things. I've made myself kind of harder to find. It's my screen name, which is
look behind you. Move your so they can see it on YouTube. There you go. Yeah.
That's Oddo, E-A-U-X-D-D-E-A-U-X. Is that reversed?
No, I can see it.
Okay. All right, cool. Yeah, so that's my handle at most things on like Instagram and all that. But I think you can get there just through my website. You should, because that's the purpose of that. It should. Okay. And if it's not, I need to fix it. So just go to pauloddo.com, and if you can't find me through there, that's on me.
Okay. Well, you know, what's funny is all we've talked about is you being a painter, but you're a stand-up comic. Like,
oh yeah.
Do you have shows coming up or you're doing Moon Tower?
Yeah, I'm doing Moon Tower. And then April? And then in May, I'm going over to the other side of the world into Eastern Europe to do some shows for the United States military. And my parents are not excited about that, but I feel like, you know, if anything pops off, while I'm there, the damage is me. Y'all aren't any safer here. yeah. Way that I'm so, but it should be something special. It always is. It's something I'm super, super appreciative of being able to do, and it's extremely rewarding, personally rewarding. But yeah, since I've been back in Austin or back in Texas and now in Austin, I've been doing a lot more stand up than I was doing in New York. There's more here and it's more accessible and it's not quite as, you don't have to elbow around to try to get on stage like you have to in New York. It's the rhythm of doing stand-up in New York doesn't really agree with me in the way that you have to be so pushy. Yeah. And I don't like to be real pushy about, you know, I don't like to be anywhere I don't feel welcome. Yeah. And that doesn't fit very well in show business, but it works better here. So I've been doing a bunch of shows and I'm lining up a lot more. And so Moon Tower will be the best place to see me soon.
Awesome.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. It was really fun.
It was fun.
Yeah.
Get back on with you guys. I've been listening and the show's great. And I'm really glad you guys are sticking with it. Maybe, we'll talk about the other things that can be done later on. But I'd love to see you guys doing like a Twitch thing.
Yeah.
It'd be fun. Because that's a whole nother fun. But there's so many fucking things to do. It's hard to keep up.
Yeah, I know. It's a lot.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to put this episode out on Monday, and then, but after that, it's going to be Ben's turn to choose a song, and he says he'll have to surprise us with it.
It's going to be a shocker. My God. I don't know what we're going to do.
Yeah, all right.
The truth is, I didn't hold up my end of the bargain. I don't know what we're doing next week.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I sprung it on you too, because I think it was supposed to be my turn, but then we skipped a week, so we'll figure it out.
No worries. This is fun. We had a lot of laughs.
I know. Thank you, Paul.
Let's go live again sometime.
Into it.
All right. I'm going to shut us down. Goodbye, everybody.
We did it. Bye.
Should we vogue? Let's vogue.
And
vogue.
1, 2, 3. Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees and to Sarah Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.